Hello everybody, thanks for joining this webinar about application-based phased array inspection. I'm Thomas Falsten. I'm now working since roughly 33 years with our company CrowdGrammar in the beginning, now today Regate Technologies. I'm the support for our technical direct sales and also for our general partner in Europe, and have the pleasure to introduce to you our Mentor UT system. Before we start, we want to cover a few housekeeping items. At the bottom of your screen are multiple application engagement tools you can use. All these engagement tools are resizable and movable, so feel free to move them around to get the most out of your desktop space. You can expand your slide area or maximize it to full screen by clicking on the arrows in the top right corner. If you have any questions during the webcast, you can submit them through the Q&A engagement tool. We will try to answer this during the webcast, but if a fuller answer is needed or we run out of time, it will be answered later via email. Please know we do capture all questions. A copy of today's slide deck is and additional help materials are available in the resource list. We encourage you to download any resources or links that you might find useful. So now we will start with our app-based phased array inspection lecture for today. So our topics for today are, first of all, of course, have a look back to the past of ultrasonic inspection and what we do today. After that, we wanted to introduce you the app-based inspection and use for this also some examples out of the railway and automotive industry, from the power and energy producer, aerospace and wind turbine operators using composite materials, and we will a little bit speak about app design and remote collaboration. If you have a look on this page here, you see a little bit the development of ultrasonic flow detectors from the past until today. When I started, for example, in 87 with our company, the very left instrument was still up to date and was very modern. It consists of course, of a cathode ray tube. It had some knobs and switches, and that limited the functionality. You couldn't have more parameter on that instrument as switches and knobs are there. And of course, the screen size was also a bit limited. And most important is, if you want to have any kind of upgrade for such an instrument, most of the time you had to buy a new instrument. You couldn't just add some functionality to it. Later, we start to digitize the instruments, first just on the instrument operation side, later on also on the screen side. And on the right side, you see our contemporary flow detectors, USM36, USM Go Plus, and the USM60. Nowadays, of course, all of these instruments are equipped with digital screens, are menu-driven, so it's much easier to maybe to operate them. It's much easier to upgrade them. If you, let's say, want to add functionality on a base instrument, you can still do that, and you still use the same instrument. It's the same way to operate it. But if you look for all of these instruments, they have one thing in common. The way how you operate the switches and knobs or the menus was defined by our engineering. Okay, we of course we took some time and looked for our customers and asked them, of course, what would be the best way to use it. But anyway, you will never meet or come to the point that you will have the concept, an operating concept, which is really good for everybody. There was an exception historically. There was a company who asked us to modify one of our digital or first digital instruments. And they said, okay, the instrument is nice, but there are too much features in with regards to our operators and with our application. So therefore, they gave us a list and of parameters which we have to remove from our standard menu. So we did it, resorted the menus, and they got their personalized instrument. But at the end, this customer bought more than 100 instruments, So that makes sense for us and for everybody to modify things like that. But you can't do that on an instrument by instrument basis. So it means the majority of the customers, if you're not such a big customer or user of the instruments, you have to live with the point that we as a manufacturer will specify how the instruments will be operated. Here you see the latest development in our company. It's the future, not only the future, it's also today's phased array inspection tool we developed. Looks quite different from what you have seen on the last slide. Now we are using touch screens. We are working with workflows or applications which adapt the user interface of the instrument to the test task or the inspection task you want to do. And in addition, you also have the possibility to remote collaborate with this instrument with some colleagues which are maybe not on the site where you do the inspection. When you start the instrument, you will see this opening screen on the instrument. So instead of just having an A-scan or vector scan view, whatever, you now see not ultrasonic data first. The first thing which you will see on the instrument is a row of small icons. Each icon belongs to one application. So it's quite similar to what you have on your mobile phone. Each application dedicated to a set specific inspection task. So let us, if you go through this small icons, you see now at the moment, for example, we have one application, the second from in the first row from the left. It's a double-sided weld inspection. We have bolt inspection, we have bond seam inspection, conventional inspection, which is of course also possible with some Mentor UT. Or if you want to go for corrosion, you have the really lower right application on the screen too, which you can use for that. So depending of the task you want to do, you just have to select the right application. And you see the three dots on the bottom of the screen. Like on the mobile phone, you have of course the possibility to use more than just this one screen for applications. You can add as many screens as you want and as you have applications. Before we go further to see some applications which we have solved with a Mentor UT, just a short question. Have you ever used Mentor UT for an inspection, or is it completely new for you? Please let us know. The first applications we will have a closer look to are all related to railway or to automotive industry. Our first example, the SAMT, the Solid Axle Manual Testing System. This system was developed for one of our customers in Italy, who is one of the biggest producers of railway axles, hover axles, and solid axles, both. And he wanted to replace his manual inspection by something which is more efficient, faster, and gives a better documentation. So what you see on the photo in the middle of this slide is a top view on our SAMT system. You see the magnet with the centering cone, which holds the whole SAMT system in the centering hole of the axle. We have an encoder, of course, to record the movement of our probe. On the right side, you see the probe with the wedge, with the probe holder, which is spring-loaded, so to keep always a good coupling. And as coupling, we are using just normal grease or coupling, which you also know from other standard UT applications. We got an axle which looked a bit more sophisticated than the one you see here on this slide. And this axle he gave us actually had up to 8 artificial flaws. And the aim was, of course, to find all these 8 flaws in one turn of your probe. So as already said, we are able to tailor the user interface to the application. That's what you see also here now on the screen. On the left side, you see the, let's say, so-called setup screen. So here you have the possibility to set all the parameters to optimize your echo from your artificial reference flow. So that is basically, of course, the scanning angles. It's a range start and the range end where you expect to have the critical part on your axle. And it could be, of course, the amplification. Once you have done this for one flow area, you can do that for the second, third, and so on. And up to 8 different settings can be stored on the instrument. You see it then on the right side, that is on the picture what the inspector would see while he's doing the inspection. On the right side, you see 8 strips representing all the 8 areas where we expect the flaws. There's the 8 critical areas on this axle with a B scan. On the left side of this right picture, you see this sector scan, a TAE scan, which belongs to the position of the cursor inside the scan on the right side. So you can always select one of the scans and one position inside this scan to see the sector scan and the TAE scan on the left side for this particular flow. So our next example covers maybe a little bit exotic application within the automotive industry. It's a battery pole inspection, so the poles of the starter battery, which we still have in most of our cars. You see on the left side what the people have done in the past. They took the battery out, cut the pole, and had a look at the quality between the butt, which is located in the topper cap of the battery, and the pole, which comes from the last cell of the battery. Both parts are soldered together, and one critical point for the quality of such a battery is how deep is this soldering done. So, as I said, in the past, they took batteries out, cut them, and then somebody has to view it and to judge if this soldering is good or bad. This is, of course, a very costly way because they did it not only with 1, 2, 3 batteries. They did it with hundreds of batteries in this three-shift production. So there was a lot of scrap produced just to see the quality of the soldering. So this company came to us and asked us if we would have a solution which is non-destructively. We developed a special probe. You see it on the left. Onto the pole, so we have a linear array which sounds straight into the pole, and you have to turn it around one time. The idea behind is that you get no backward reflection if the soldering is good and the sound goes into the pole. The material is lead, so we have a very high sound attenuation, so we won't see any backward echo. If there is no soldering anymore, you get the echo back just from the cap of this battery pole. And of course, the distances are not so long. You will get a backpole echo. That's what you see in the picture in the middle. You see an area which is welded or soldered, where you have no backpole echo. And then suddenly an area starts where you get a backpole echo just from the head of the battery pole. And the people who do this inspection have just to see how long this area which is welded actually is. As these people used before the saw and their eyes to do an inspection, who had never got any sophisticated UT training, we also had to simplify the application. We know this application looks always the same. So it's always the same battery poles, it's always the same thing to do, it's always the same probe. That means we set up in our application, in our user interface, which you see on the right side, we set up every parameter and we remove this parameter. So the operator himself is not able to manipulate any parameter which is important for the application. For the result of the inspection. So that's what you see also on the screen. You have only a few symbols on the data views, which gives you access to certain menus. And even inside the different menus, also see that there are only a few parameters left. So we removed all parameters which are not important for this application, and especially where we don't want the operator to change anything. So we get a very consistent inspection. Every time operator starts to do this inspection, he has a preset probe. He will always have the same view on the screen. So more or less, there's no possibility to manipulate the inspection procedure. Here we see a second application example out of the automotive industry, the bond seam inspection. So that is an inspection done, for example, at the doors of the automobile. At the bottom side and at the sides, the metal sheet, the outer metal sheet is bended around, and you have some sealing material, some glue inside this joint. And the question now was, of course, is this glue sealing evenly distributed over the whole length of the door? Point behind this, of course, if there's any opening, water can penetrate into it, and then it's, of course, the door starts to corrode. In the past, they used destructive or different destructive methods. One you see here on the upper pictures, destroying the door, cuts the door, and then peels the critical area or area away, and then you get the view to the glued area. And you can judge the quality of this glued area. This is, of course, first of all, a very costly inspection, as you have to scrap the parts afterwards, like it is with the batteries. And it's a very slow inspection, as from the time you get the result back to the production line, a lot of other doors may have been errorly filled with glue. So the Volkswagen came to us in this case, so Volkswagen Saxonia, and asked us if we have a possibility to do non-destructive testing. First of all, faster. And second of all, you get a documentation, and you see now also easily where you have areas which are maybe critical with regards to the filling. So we developed a special probe, which you see on the lower left picture. It's a phased array probe with 62 or 32 elements, which are flexible so that they can follow the contour of the part. You have an encoder on it to record, of course, the movement. And on the right side, you see the result of such a scan. You see the width of your probe. And on the horizontal line, you see the whole length of your test piece. So on top of this C-scan, you see the area where you have just no join anymore, where you have just one plate, which is red. And every other area in between, where you see red, should be an area where you have no glue. To verify this, we got different doors from Volkswagen, which have been prepared for the inspection. We did first the UT inspection, and then afterwards they did the destructive testing. And you can see here from this example, UT inspection and destructive testing fits very well together. So as most of the inspectors who have to do this UT inspection on the bond seam are not really UT inspectors, we developed a workflow which should make it easy for them to follow up all the steps necessary to get a good inspection result at the end. So the first page of this workflow shows all the necessary equipment needed for this application, the probe, and how the probe shall be placed on the part, how the probe has to be connected to the instrument. He has to take in his name so that you later on can trace the inspection results by the inspector. He has to go to some more steps just by pressing the right arrow on the bottom of the screen, and he automatically comes to the next page. He has to do a sensitivity calibration, of course. And if he clicks through the, or goes step by step through the application at the end, he finds the picture which we see on the right side on this slide, where it shows us the inspection page. So the page which is then used for the inspection itself. On this page, you see on the bottom the C-scan, which we have already seen on the slide before. Above the larger C-scan, you see a smaller C-scan, which is just a magnified part out of the complete scan. You see that the operator can type in some comments about this, the result of this, his inspection. And of course, a small picture which shows him where the inspection shall be take place. So everything made in a way that it simplifies the inspection as much as possible. Before we go further, we have a small question for you. How many years of experience do you have in ultrasonic inspection? So the next few applications I want to show you and the workloads which belongs to these applications are more or less all out of the area of power suppliers, power production. The first example out of this industry brings us to New Mexico, where a big solar energy plant was, or is. The problem there was that the converter, which I used to convert the power from direct current to alternating current, produce a lot of heat, so you need some cooling plates inside this converter. These cooling plates are basically aluminum plates which have some cooling channels inside where you have a cooling liquid in. And what happens was that this converter cooling panels starts to corrode and that cooling liquid runs out of the panel. So the question was, how can we detect this corrosion in a very fast way on the location, also again with some unexperienced ultrasonic inspector. The customer was located in Germany, in Berlin, so we need also the first time the remote collaboration beside a specific app for this application. First of all, we sat down and tried to develop a nice application, which in our case means we are using two groups instead of the 8 we have seen in the beginning with the axle. Now it's only two groups. One group is the parameters are modified for the upper part of the cooling channel, and the settings for the second group are modified for the lower part of the cooling channel. So in this case, you only have to do one scan, and you have covered the complete cooling plate, the upper part and the lower part of the cooling channel, which have been critical. So on the right-hand side, you see left, the two pictures from the upper and lower channel, if there is no corrosion. And on the right side, you see an example where we have eroded or corroded cooling channels. Color in this case means, of course, thickness, remaining wall thickness. So if you have white or blue, the thickness is quite thin, or there's no response anymore. So also here, to help the operator to do his inspection task, we developed a specific application, a specific workflow for this kind of corrosion inspection, which consists of four different steps. Normally we have one entry page and title page where you can have basic information about this app, basically for what it is used for. Important, I think, also the name of the developer of this application, the version number, and so on. Then by pressing the right arrow key on the bottom, the operator can move from one page to the next and is guided through the setup of the probe until he comes to the final page where you have his inspection picture, where just the inspection is done. So this makes it relatively easy also for not very experienced inspectors to do this kind of test. In this case, as I said already, we used also the remote collaboration. So the test was done in New Mexico, and it was directly remotely transferred to somebody in Berlin, Germany, at the same time, who was sitting on the screen, just watched what the results are from the scanning. And then they could immediately decide if this panel has to be changed or not. So it was a good example for simplifying an application by using a simple app, plus the possibility of a remote collaboration. I have somebody more experienced here in Germany, and somebody in this case who do the inspection on the location. Another example out of the energy production area is this one. It's a boiler tube weld inspection, so a conventional thermal power plant. Most of you will know that you have a big walls of heat exchanger consisting of tubes where the cooling fluid runs through. These tubes are welded together and have to be inspected from time to time. The problem up to now was that in most of the cases, this inspection was done by X-ray, which is, of course, time-consuming, has to be done when everybody else has left the place. You need some time for developing. And just the next morning, you can start to repair if there was, if you found any flaw on the X-ray film. So we tried to do the same inspection with OQT, and we developed or used a scanner for this, which is a very small one, with a UT probe in, so that you can really clamp this scanner on the tube, turn the probe with the scanner once around the tube, and you have this valve inspected from one side. You turn it down, and you can look, have a look from the other side of the valve. It's a much faster way to do valve inspection than you can do it with X-ray. And the big benefit, of course, is you can do the UT inspection during the day. So you have no extra cost for night shifts. And if anything is found, it can be directly, instantly be repaired. So to make this inspection more convenient for the inspector, also here we developed a workflow which consists of different steps. The two you see here on this slide. On the left side, you see the page where the encoder calibration, for example, has to be done, or the encoder has to be checked if the resolution is correctly set. So you see, you can always put pictures, drawings, and text into your application so that you can really tell the operator what he has to do. You have measurement windows, the small boxes on the bottom of the screen, for example, which gives you actual values while he does the calibration. He has a photo that explains him how to do it. And so it becomes much more easy to understand what to do and to follow the procedure as it should be done. On the right picture, you see then once all the calibration steps have been done, the picture which is used for the inspection itself. In this case, you see on the just on the upper top, of course, on the very left upper side point, the gain. So you have settings, parameter settings on the screen on the one side, and on the right side on the top, you have some measurement values. So you are free to deselect, of course, any measurement value or any parameter you want to have direct access on the surface of your user interface. So you can put it there by yourself. Below that, you see this complete C-scan, and underneath, again, a magnified area of the C-scan and a magnified area of the B-scan, plus vector scan and the world overlay, and of course, an individual A-scan from one of the position of the beam cursor. So you have all the information you retrieve on one page. You can still operate major functionalities by the parameter knobs which are on your screen, and you see the inspection results or the measurement values directly on top of the screen. And this screen or all these screens are now arranged in a way how you want to have it, how you think it is good for you and for your operation and for your inspection task. One more example out of the energy producing area, but which is not only found there, but could of course be also be actual in some other applications, which has nothing to do with energy production, is a bolt inspection. But for us, it was one of the first times we got in contact with that was related to the wind industry. So you may know most of the wind towers are produced by segments, and these segments are all bolted together. And the whole tower itself is then bolted on the ground. In addition, also you have the blades, which are also bolted. So you have a lot of bolts used to hold a wind generator together. And of course, over the time, while it's operating, you get a lot of wind load, for example, on this tower. So you have a dynamically load on this, on the whole construction, and that could, of course, lead to cracks in the bolts. The problem, of course, is you can't just unscrew the bolt and inspect it. If that would be possible, you could use penetrant or the current inspection, and you would have a very easy job. But in this case, as we cannot remove the bolt itself, so we have to further use ultrasonic inspection. And here, again, helps us a probe which has a cover foil or a protection foil underneath, which looks straight into the material and swipe over a range of plus minus 20 to 30 degrees. So what you see on the picture in the middle is just the scan area, so you see the cut through our bolt. On top is, of course, the top of the bolt, then you see the reflections which comes out of the thread. And then you get a small underneath the thread, you get a small indication which shows us the crack. And of course, at the bottom, you see the back wall, or the bottom of the bolt, or the head of the bolt, depending from which side you are bringing your sound into the bolt. So you have a very easy to understand and then very easy to detect screen. And again, as we have seen it already on the other pictures, here you have a dedicated workflow which shows you what to do on a certain step during the calibration, or how you have to do the inspection itself. So if you look to the right picture, for example, on this slide, it is one of the last pages before the inspection starts. Again, we incorporated a picture to make sure that the probe is coupled in the proper way. On the left side on this picture, you see again some explanations done for the inspector, what he has to observe. And once he has read this page, he can just go to the next page and he would be able to do the inspection. The last application for today is composite inspection. This is, of course, an application which you not only find, let's say, in wind energy projects, as we have seen just before, but also in aerospace. For this application, we use a probe which is called a rotor array. This is basically a linear, normally 64-element phased array probe, which sits on the axle of this rotor roller. You have a rubber around which do most of the coupling, and of course in between of the wheel you have some coupling liquid. So now you are able to roll over your part, and as the rubber wheel do already most of the coupling, you only need a little bit of water to have really a good contact between the probe and the surface. This application could be, as you see it on the left picture, be in aerospace, of course, but you have similar applications also for wind blade inspection, where table laminations starts to come up over the time of operation. In aerospace, basically more the question of damaging while the planes are on ground. The big difficulty for new planes is, of course, that if some car, for example, hit the body on the ground of the airport, you most likely don't see any damage. other than like in as in, when it was still aluminium. So therefore, we have one large customer for this rotor array here in Europe, who basically gives this probe to more or less every plane, so that, as we will always be able on a certain airport to check if there could have been any laminations. What you do is, of course, you roll over the over part of interest, and what you see is what you see on the right picture, which gives you again a C-scan or the color-coded view, top view onto your part to be tested, and either color represents amplitude or it represents time of flight. You will always see the critical areas inside your test piece. This slide shows you how to set up the rotor array probe. That means all the steps the operator has to do, and he has is guided through with his rotor array application or workflow. So the first thing when he starts this application, he's asked to do an element check. So he has to check if all of the 64 elements, for example, are really working properly, if the sensitivity is good enough, or if some elements maybe are dead. In the second step, he has to set up the interface gate so that the entrance echo on the screen is always visible and not moving. One step further, you have, of course, to do a sound velocity calibration. Later on, now on the lower right side, the DCG calibration, sensitivity calibration, check if the encoder is correct, and in the last step, then you can, of course, go to your inspection page. So here we see the last page of all the steps you have to follow through the workflow until to come to this final page, which gives you the inspection page. Again, freely designable, which means it could look as you want to have it looking. So in this case, we use, for example, on the left lower side, the C-scan, right next to the C-scan, you have an enlarged view part of the C-scan. On the top, the E-scan, A-scan, and of course some measurements, and again, also some parameters which you want to have access to by using them directly or not through the menu icons. Yeah, it's the end of our presentation here today. I would just tell you a little bit how such an application can be done by you and how the remote collaboration will work. Now, together with the Mentor UT, you will get a software which is called Mentor Create, which has to be installed on a PC, not on the instrument itself, to design such kind of workflows. It's a bit similar to using PowerPoint. You get an empty page, and then you can move on each corner of this page any element you want to have there. If it is a C-scan, if it's an E-scan, if it's a sector scan, A-scan, if it's some parameter boxes, if it's some measurement boxes. You just select them on the right side of the screen, place them on the position in the screen where you want them to be, and in this way you can create step by step one page of your app to the next one. So you decide also which parameters are accessible for the operator. Normally, if you take standard applications, in most cases all parameters are open, so every parameter can be changed like on any other, let's say, standard phased array instrument. If you want to restrict the access to certain parameters, like we have seen, for example, in the application for the battery pole inspection, you can restrict parameters, you can lock them, they are still visible, or you can remove them as we did it in this application for the battery, for example, so the operator doesn't see them. The instrument starts up with the right settings, and you have to decide if the operator, the inspector, is able to change these parameters or not. You can add documents, as you have seen, Word files, PDF files, pictures, videos, if you want, to make it more easier for the operator to understand what he has to do and to follow the inspection procedure. In case you say, okay, but it is all lot of work just to have a simplified workflow, you still have the choice to use the workflows which we provide to you. So we call them the golden workflows. So for many applications, we have designed some workflows which you can then use as they are. Or maybe you use these applications then to copy them and adapt them to your needs. Once the workflow is done and ready, you need a USB stick or USB memory device to transfer your application from the PC to the instrument. As we have seen in the application for the corrosion monitoring of the aluminium panels, cooling panels in the solar power plant, the inspector at site was communicating with a remote expert somewhere else in the world. This works via a Wi-Fi connection or mobile hotspot. One possibility would be, of course, that both are in the same network. If it's the same company, for example, then it's easy. If you are on two different remote places, like we had this example for New Mexico and Berlin, you can use so-called virtual router, which are connect you in the internet both together. So the inspector has to open his instrument first, and then the expert has access to the instrument and can look what the operator is seeing. So there is no possibility that somebody can observe the inspector or the screen of the instrument of the inspector if he do not have by himself allowed to do that. That is a very important part. So the inspector has to open the possibility that somebody else has a possibility to have a view on his screen or has a possibility to remotely operate his instrument. If you do not want to use a router or a virtual router and it is always too complicated, maybe you have another possibility, which is our own cloud solution called Inspection Works Connect. If you decide to go through this connection, the inspector only needs to type in the email address of the one who shall have a look on his screen. The email is sent to the expert. He only has to click on a link in this email and he's automatically connected with the instrument. The only point is that in this case, he is only able to view the screen, but he cannot operate it. On the other side, it is, of course, a very simple way to connect two instruments without knowledge or without too much knowledge of computer and remote collaborations. Before you leave our webinar now today, we would like to ask you how likely it would be if you would build your own app as you have seen it just a few slides before. It would be nice if you could answer us this question. Thanks a lot. So as a summary, one can say that of course our changing age structure and demographic development, we see more people leaving our business than just following it up. And that means that a lot of knowledge and experience could got lost, and maybe, and that is our idea behind all these Mentor UT possibilities, that it is possible to keep knowledge, to keep experience on the instrument. In this case, if the people take time for this, you can not only store a data set and tell your inspector if you recall this or that data set, you can do the inspection. In addition to this data set, you can store any other information which is maybe needed or which should be of importance for the inspector. That could be, of course, UT informations. That could be maybe informations about the test piece. It could be informations about the customer if you are an inspection company, for example. So we try with this way to keep knowledge and make the losses in experience as small as possible. Another point, of course, is if you look back in the last years, The compliance rules become stricter. Safety regulations became stricter. The demand for documentation became much bigger than it was in, let's say, 20, even 10 years ago. So we think with this ease of use, it is also much easier to show, if it necessary, that a certain procedure was really followed step by step. And documentation is just the press of a knob. If more people leave our business and will follow up us, that means also the productivity must become higher. We have increased requirements and maybe also increased demand for inspection. On the other side, not as much people as before. So you can try to do, first of all, with history, and if you have to, if you can simplify the use of it, you can also increase the productivity. You can get people faster to work and to get a safer inspection result. And if you sum up all of this together, you try to share experience with an application-specific app. That could be the conclusion, or should be the conclusion of our operating concept. We are at the end of our presentation, and I thank you for your attendance. We are coming to the end of our webinar today. If you have any questions or comments, please give them us now. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, everyone, for taking the time to join us today for Waygate Technologies' app-based phased array inspection presentation. Thank you very much, Thomas, for that wonderful presentation. It was very, very informative. I wanted to start off the live Q&A session with some of the questions that we've received sort of over the course of the presentation. So I wanted to start with a question around inspection of gears. Is it possible with the device to get good results from inspection of gears?
Yes, we have done something on big gears, which are used in wind turbines, for example. So we placed a ray probe on top of it. It did basically the same as you have seen with the bolt inspection. We sweep the beam plus minus a certain angle to reach, let's say, the edge screws. But the only limitation is, of course, the diameter. You have a space to get the probe put on. Minimum contact area is 10 millimeter diameter. If you have that space, we can do something on your ear tools.
Okay, thank you. What is the biggest advantage of the Mentor UT from your perspective?
Because the ease of use, and that you can really suit an application or suit an app for a particular application. So as you've seen, if you have experienced operators, you can keep every parameter open, keep him working with the instrument. If you have inexperienced operators, or you have non-UT people, basically, like the battery pole as an example, you can really simplify even a, such a complex instrument like the Mentor UT or the phased array instrument. And simplify it to the point that you really can give it to everybody and work with it for his particular application.
Wonderful, thank you. For some of your examples that you gave during your presentation for the bolt inspection portion, what probe type is used?
Probes we use, it's basically derived from our conventional probes. It's a straight beam probe, 24 or 10 millimeter in diameter, and cut it into 16 elements. So it's not a probe really to suitable for linear scans, but very nice probe to use for this kind of inspection, like bolt. So you have a protective foil in front, so you have no delay line, so you are no, have no limitations from the delay line for the length of the bolt, for example. You don't need to hear multiple echoes from your delay line. The crystal is protected and you can easily work. And as I said, we have, let's say, two different kinds. One is 24 millimeter, 2 and 4 megahertz. The other one is 10 millimeter, 2 and 4 megahertz.
can work with both of these four probes.
Great. And in your presentation that you gave, what was the typical diameter of the boiler tubes that we were showing that example on?
For this system which you have shown there, the palm scanner, we have three palm scanners. First one is for 1.5 to 2 inch. The second size is from 2 to 2.5 inch. The last one is from 2.5 to 3.5.
Wonderful. And in regards to Mentor UT, can you talk about any development or current features as it pertains to spot weld inspection?
Yes, we are working on spot weld inspection application. Well, you can have a look in our lab for that. We think we are already in summer, so in summertime, during this summer, we'll be able also to do spot weld inspection. Latest.
Okay.
We're working together with one big German car producer to get this application really ready and suited to their demands.
And can the C-scan roller be used for rail testing?
Principle, yes. I have a little bit here that that the rubber, the steel of the array, would become dirty because it's a very soft plastic or rubber material. I think the surface of the piece to be tested is not really clean, and really is not really clean. So you will have very easily dirt on the roll. Must clean the roll, but I have to say that I have not much experience with the rotor array on steel. I just heard from another customer in UK, he used it on big tanks for corrosion monitoring, and he got no problem. So I think it is something that which has to be tried, see if it's really usable. In principle, from the physical principle, it would work. Only question is how easily is it, or how fast is it dirty.
Okay, thank you. And can Mentor UT be used in flow line inspection?
Sorry, but what inspection?
I'm sorry, Thomas, you might be breaking up. Can the Mentor UT be used in flow line inspection?
Area. I can't answer that question because I don't know what exactly you want to inspect.
Okay, no problem. We can follow up with that later. On the roto array probe, what is the smallest size available?
The smallest of, so we can do roto arrays down to 10-50 millimeters, in, let's say, in length. But let's say for the rotor array you have seen on our presentation today, it is 32 element. Oh God, I have to see. Moment. It's maybe 6 centimeter. Any width is the smallest one for this type of roll, but we can make it smaller if needed. We have a smaller one for this glue line, bond line inspection, for example. You have seen a linear probe, but we have done a roller probe for that also. So that was just 10-50 millimeters length. But it would be good to know from you which diameter you need, length you need.
Okay, great. And what other UT applications could be also solved by Mentor UT?
Basically everything you can use, you can solve this conventional UT. Let's say we have, for example, we have one customer who is the Mentor UT for bond inspection. So you have two materials bonded together and he is inspecting the bonding. Would be an example. The gear teeth is an inspection, would be an example from that. Spot weld will be there in soon. weld inspection, the typical weld inspection which we have everywhere on pipes, on vessels, where which weld parts are which are welded. That are the basic applications I have seen up to now. I've seen it in turbine maintenance, that they are used cement. Corrosion monitoring is a quite big area, so you have to map a larger area for corrosion. Mentor UT could be a choice.
Thank you, Thomas. In these applications, is the sound field multiple focused or with only one focus?
This was a question for the rotary. You know, so normally we use it unfocused, and if you the focus, you can use just one fixed focus. I think in this application.
Great, and we're coming up to the top of the hour. So if there are any other open questions, once this session is over, we will make sure and follow up via email. The next question is, does this device have a TFM beam?
Not yet, but I think in autumn we'll have it also included. Even so, I do not see the, let's say, the general use for it, but it will be coming in, will come in, I would guess, autumn.
Wonderful. And are there any other new methods or instruments that that are specific to the inspection of pipeline that might be forthcoming or recently available from Waygate?
So that's just a question besides the Mentor UT. No, I don't see anything. Maybe it, what I see, especially with pipeline inspection or with long-range inspection, guided waves are become more and more common, but that is something not related to the Mentor UT. But there, besides that, I haven't seen any specific, let's say, new development which is different from what we already know for pipe inspection.
Can the Mentor UT equipment be used to take UT measurements on flow line?
Yes, you can do it with any other instrument. You can also do with.
Wonderful. Thank you, Thomas. So does the Mentor UT have a layout for complex geometry, or how would that, what would be those best practices around that?
Yes, you can lay out weld geometry, and also use the unsymmetrical weld.
And our final question, can the Mentor UT be used for bearing?
Yes, as I said already, it's possible to use for bearings. So for the bearing means for tooth inspection of the bearings, or is it the bearing itself? So it depends what you are looking for exactly. If it's a tooth, yes, if the teeth is big enough, work with other parts of the bearing, where and what exactly has effect.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for your time today, Thomas. We really appreciate, and thank you all attendees that took time out of their schedules to join us today. We will be following up with you via email if we did not get to your question. So we look forward to having you join us in the future. This concludes our session. for Waygate Technologies app-based phased array inspection. Thank you and have a wonderful day.